some major developments in Hong Kong and the Chinese Communist Party. Essentially, a national security law has been officially passed by the Chinese government pertaining to Hong Kong, which will allow and set forth for its implementation in September for a crackdown on these protesters. Now, this is something that Hong Kong pro-democracy protesters had long. The original protest had been around essentially a similar type of law, which allows Chinese government authority to essentially repatriate Hong Kong citizens, or not Hong Kong, Hong Kong residents, to mainland China. It was seen as an effort for Chinese oligarchs who have long looked at Hong Kong-based financiers as direct threats to their business and their ability to use the corrupt system there to crack down on their business enemies. That focuses on all that. Of course, it encompasses Hong Kong's special status, which is something that's been long reflected by the United States government in our special trading relationship with Hong Kong. Now, yesterday, Secretary of State Mike Pompeo informed the United States Congress that Hong Kong has lost autonomy in the view of the Secretary of State. Now, that special autonomy was very important because we have a special trade and economic relationships with Hong Kong to the tune of literally tens of billions of dollars. So this impacts a lot of the global financial system, of course, which are headquartered in Hong Kong, do a lot of trade in Hong Kong.
Right.
And we know that, I mean, so much of the world's financial system and trading relationship with China have their headquarters in Hong Kong. So the Chinese government is basically making a play here in order to take over much of that financial sector. They have long viewed Hong Kong's independence as kind of a thorn in its side, and they want to have total control over the direction of their country under Xi Jinping's leadership of that country.
Right. I mean, the basic dynamic is just sort of creeping levels of increasing control, especially in terms of judicial control, security control. And so this latest move has triggered the Trump administration essentially saying, we don't see you as separate. We don't see you as, we can't maintain this fiction that you have a special relationship anymore because there isn't this separation from mainland China that there used to be. This is a move that has been cheered, by the way, by the Hong Kong democracy protesters because it sends a strong signal, because it does have potentially broad-reaching implications and ramifications that the Chinese government will not be happy about, including potential tariff increases and things like that. Politically, part of why we cover the protests here, of course, which were massive and ongoing and really, really significant last year, last fall, part of why those have tamped down some is because of COVID.
Coronavirus.
Which is like a real, I actually think that that's an important dynamic in this story and other protests that we're covering here and around the world, is it does severely limit your ability to dissent. So I do think that is an important dynamic to consider here. The political ramifications are obviously really important domestically here as well. President Trump has pinned a lot of his reelection campaign, although I feel like they're kind of dialing back on this lately, on his stance of being tough on China, hitting Joe Biden. Joe Biden came out with this ad saying, no, you're the one that's soft on China. I'm tough on China.
Right.
So this, again, sort of puts that political dynamic back front and center. On the other hand, this could kind of spark another trade war, which we kind of had a truce on. So that creates some political dynamics as well. But the bottom line and the important dynamic here is that, you know, the Trump administration is essentially taking the side of the Hong Kong pro-democracy protesters in a way that is quite quite aggressive and quite bold.
And let me tell you why I'm very enthused about this. Because for too long, American politicians and presidents have gone to the United Nations and been like, China is violating human rights. And then they'll turn around and allow every major U.S. corporation to go and base jobs out of Shenzhen while sell out factories in Detroit. And for the first time ever, this is what the whole trade war, this is the one thing that Trump has moved everything on forever, is that you hit somebody where it actually hurts. The Chinese government does not care if you go to the United Nations and criticize them over their human rights record. What they care way more about is if you disrupt the Made in China 2025 plan, if you disrupt the One Belt, One Road initiative, if you go after them economically, the center of gravity for the Chinese Communist Party is their rule over the Chinese people. The Chinese people give them legitimacy because the Communist Party, since the days of Deng Xiaoping, have said, we are going to give you economic growth, prosperity, and restore China to its rightful place amongst nations. It doesn't have actually all that much to do with communism. It has much more to do with how it's like state-controlled industrial enterprise.
That's what it is,
right?
Really.
I mean, essentially, that's what it is. So you have to go and target it at the very heart of that, which is built and financed by American, by Wall Street and by American big business, because it's cheaper for them in the short term. So this is something where we have to change the way that we interact with nations on this level. Because like, it's like with North Korea or any of these, like going out and calling somebody's human rights record means nothing if you're not actually gonna back it up.
Yeah.
But nobody ever wanted to back it up, because the moment you start going after the profits of HSBC Bank, the moment that you start going after the profits of so many companies which are based out of China, Hong Kong, and others, they're screaming. They're like, hey, please don't do anything about this. They don't care about the protesters. They don't actually care about human rights. They care about the bottom line. So if you actually want to care about those people, it actually is a mutually exclusive choice.
Well, the theory from the sort of mainline theory in this town has been basically liberalism and market interactions would ultimately sort of magically lead to an end to, I mean, that is really the theory, right? And to your point, there was a lot of scaremongering around the idea of a trade war. It was like, oh my God, we can't have a trade war because that would just be the end of everything. I'm not going to say that there wasn't any pain, especially since I'm not one of the farmers who was most directly impacted. But the country survived, got through it.
Yeah.
It was fine before pre-pandemic. Yeah. You know, I mean, look, it was a disaster in all the ways that America has been a disaster for working class Americans that we talk about here all the time.
Sure.
But you know, all of the sort of doomsday sayers about the trade war and how it would be the end of everything, it wasn't true.
It didn't come to pass. Right.
And so you kind of have taken the energy out of that threat of it will be the destruction of everything if we push back, if we impose tariffs, if we get into a trade war. And so I do think that that has fundamentally changed the dynamic in American politics. And I do think also, previously, it was only a few voices on the left, like Bernie Sanders, who were willing to push back on that neoliberal consensus. I mean, there wasn't basically no one on the right who was doing that. So the fact that you have now this heterodox view within the Republican Party and within the Democratic Party is also a remarkable change from past dynamics.
Yeah, it really is. It's something that I don't even see Joe. I think Joe Biden will be a disaster on China. They could be weak on China. Even he and his administration, who are filled with Chinese, you know, Chinese-friendly corporatists, not even they will be able to roll back a law like this.
He's a neoliberal. Like, that's his ideology.
Right.
That's the bottom line.
Exactly. But even the political conditions now are such that even he won't be able to roll back something like this. And I think that in the long run, that's a good thing that we have right now.
Yeah, we'll continue to follow the story. I know several of you online on our Instagram pointed out to us and wanted us to cover it, something we've been following and will continue to do.
Yeah, and we'll follow it very closely, every development. So tomorrow on Rising, friend of the show, David Sirota, he's going to join us.
And we're going to hear from Mike Breuer. He's an asparagus farmer turned Democratic Kentucky Senate candidate about his bid to unseat Mitch McConnell. We talked to his opponent in the primary, Charles Booker, today. Don't forget to hit the subscribe button so you never miss a video, and like and share as well. Have a great day, everybody.
See you guys tomorrow.